Okay. Welcome everyone. We will start in 1 or 2 minutes. I will wait for other students to join. Okay, welcome again. So today we will build a neural network with PyTorch, and we will follow a tutorial. I will send you the link of the tutorial now from the chat. Please open it. So this will be the tutorial that we will follow today. Okay. I will share my screen with you and we will go over it together. Okay. Can you hear me well? And can you see the screen well? Okay. Okay, I hope my internet connection allow me to do a good recording. Okay. So we will follow, this is a very well documented tutorial, and we will follow this tutorial, and you will see a review of what we have done until now, and we will also code it for the moment. So this is from Curiosity. Okay, so this is a deep learning tutorial with PyTorch. Okay, so as always, we start with importing some libraries. You know these libraries, I suppose. So this is the PyTorch neural network library to run neural networks on GPUs. So this is related to operating system. Usually it is for reading files. So this is numerical linear algebra. Pandas is again for reading structured data. Okay. So this is, I am not sure about this. This is for visual, how to say. Do you know this? Does anyone know this library? We can look for it. So what does it do? Let's look at it. So it is extensible progress bar. It shows you the progress. Okay. So these kinds of, so this is the bar that it shows. Okay, not that important. So you see, this is the bar that it shows. Okay, just a library. Okay, CBOS, so for it is for good visualizations. This is for, again, some parameters for figures. This is again for visualization, but this is a more advanced visualization library. This is the basic visualization library. Okay, so this is the parameter for visualization. So these are, this is scikit-learn is a very important library. It is accepted from the industry. So the companies on that use machine learning always use scikit-learn for simple machine learning jobs. So Torch is not for machine learning. It is for deep learning, but this one is for a general machine learning. You can find all the standard machine learning algorithms in that library. Just a minute. Okay, in this library, there are a lot of useful classes. One of them is train test split. So you split the data into test and train to understand the performance of your algorithm. So this is just splitting train and test data. And after that, to measure the performance, you can use confusion metrics. In one course, actually, I talk about this and we will repeat it again today. Okay, from Torch, so this is the neural network library. So this is the optimizer. For example, the gradient descent that we always talk from the beginning of the semester, it is SGD, stochastic gradient descent. So it is one of the optimizer optimization algorithm that you can find in this Optim class. So this is to build an architecture of neural network. Okay, so this is, you can use some useful functions in Torch NN function, and you can, this is when you say S PLT, maybe some of you is not familiar with Python, so what is S? So instead of writing seaborn, which is 3, 7 characters, you can write 3-character SNS. So it is shorten what you write. Again, instead of writing this much, you just say big F. So you can write a compact code. Okay, again, these are for visualizations. So these are some colors. Okay, and parameters. So what should be your figure size? It is height and width values will be 12 and 8. Okay, so this is also important for reproducibility. I want to ask you, do you know the difference between deterministic process and stochastic process? Do you know it? What is stochastic? For example, we say that gradient descent algorithm is a stochastic gradient descent algorithm. Why? Because each time it takes different data and a random data. So deterministic means that there is no randomness in the process. Stochastic means that there is a randomness. And you know, for example, I want to show. So you have a neural network like this one, and we will build this neural network in this lecture with this with the given tutorial. So you know, this is your input layer. There is one hidden layer, another hidden layer, and the output layer. And you make transformations. If you remember, the first transformation is a linear transformation. The values here, it is a vector with size 4. Actually, you transform this vector with size 4 to size 5. How do you do it? How do you do this transformation? With matrix multiplication. So this is the first transformation, linear transformation. Then you apply a activation function such as sigmoid or ReLU, and you make a nonlinear transformation. So from this layer to that layer, when you pass from here to here, actually you do two transformations. One is matrix multiplication, linear transformation. The other is a nonlinear transformation done by an activation function. Okay, what I want to tell you is there are weights here. When you make a linear transformation, you multiply it by a matrix, and matrix has some weights. So what is the matrix here? Here you have 4 neurons here, and here you have 5. So you have a matrix of 4 to 5, okay? The matrix, the size of the matrix, I'm talking about the size of the matrix. It is 4 rows and 5 columns, okay? So you have 20 elements there, 20 weight values there. Okay, these values are, if you remember, these are our parameters. And we are looking for best parameters with the gradient descent algorithm. Okay, but how do we initialize this, the value of the parameters? We initialize them by random values. Okay, so because of that, our process is a stochastic process. So there is a randomness. You don't start with with always the same numbers. You start with a random number. So to generate random numbers, we are using this random seed. And This is called reproducibility. You can reproduce a random process in another machine. For example, you have a model and you say that my model works, its performance is, its accuracy is 90%. Okay, you do it and in your computer with your random values, with your random initial values and following random steps, at the end you have 90% of accuracy, very, very well. But if you give it to me, your model, and if I try it, because of the randomness, I will obtain a different result. I can obtain a different result. To avoid this difference, we set our random seed to a number, and we will use it when we give it to the some other people. So I want to tell you, so you, for example, you are a consultant, a machine learning consultant, and you are working for a company, and you give your model to the company, and you say that I have a 90% accuracy. But the company, when it runs your algorithm, they obtain, for example, 80% accuracy. There is a difference of 10%. So 10% low. Because of that, they can say that what you say is not correct. You are lying. Okay. So to avoid it, to be able to reproduce the results again, we need this randomness, random seed values. And you see, we have two kinds of randomness. In the NumPy library, you set your random value to this given seed, and you in the torch also you have a randomness, and you see you give this random seed to that. Now your results will be reproduced with exactly same values in the when you give it to the company. Okay. Now, what we will do in this lecture, in this tutorial, we will try to predict weather. So, but in a very simple way, our simple question is, will it rain tomorrow? Okay. We, with our neural network that we will build in this lecture, we will try to understand if the weather will rain tomorrow or not. So what do we need for this product, for this prediction? First of all, okay, it is evident that we need a neural network to build or to create our model. We need that. Okay, it is good, but it's not enough. It is just a tool. What we need, the essential part is data. For these kinds of predictions, we need data. So because of that, here, the author of this tutorial say that we will use Kaggle data from this person, and we will take this data. So this is in a CSV format, and we will read it with pandas. So PD, what is PD? I want to show you again. I think half of the students know it. The other half maybe doesn't know it. I am not sure. So what is PD? Let's go here. PD, where is PD? Pandas. I don't see it. Nerede ya? Ha, buradaymış en başta. Okay, so this is pandas. So this is a very useful library for data engineering. You read data in CSV format, in Excel format, and you can manipulate the data, and you make pre-processing of the data with this pandas library. So it is very essential, especially if you will be a data engineer. So one of the tools that you need to use as a data engineer, but it is also needed for deep learning projects. So you need pandas also. Okay, at the end, you read this data and you look at the shape of the data, and you see that you have 24 columns and this much, very high number of rows. So you have a pretty good data. So it is good that, so with this a large amount of data, then you can predict the weather, okay, or any other prediction. So for a useful prediction, you need a large amount of data, especially if you are using a deep learning library. You need very huge amount of data, and it seems to be good. Okay, I want to show you Kaggle. What's Kaggle? So if you do not know it, okay, sorry. So this is the Kaggle. If you look at general Kaggle, so this is the place for finding data. So for your projects also, you can get help from here. Actually, for example, you want to work in financial data set. I don't know. I this is the first time that I see this data set. Oh, DataTurk. There is something called DataTurk. Okay, I also don't enter that much to the Kaggle. So for example, you want to make a financial prediction based on the tweets. So I don't know. Let's look at this data. What is it? Okay. Tweets from verified users concerning stock traded on the Nasdaq. Okay. So this is an interesting data. Okay. So these are the tweets from Economist Street. Okay. So these are the very important organizations related to economy. So based on their tweets, I think they want to predict something. So what is the problem? So this is maybe we should. Okay, I don't know. Okay, so this is just the data, financial data, and maybe they want to predict. Okay, so this is Stoker board. So what they want to do, I'm not sure. I can't see. Ah, okay. I hope to develop. So this is what they want to do. Sentiment text classifier that would be able to track tweeters and feelings about any publicly traded company. Okay. So based on the tweets that are in the tweets, there are texts. They make a sentiment analysis, and based on that, they want to. They want to understand public opinions about any company. Okay, so you can find any kind of data. I think they will be very interesting. So you can find data from here, and not just data, you can find also notebooks. For example, let's look at the notebooks. What kind of, so you can, if you want, you can work on coronavirus. Titanic is the starting point. Everyone starts it. So even you can look at FIFA. So I am sure some of you are very interested in football. So why you don't use your deep learning skills or data engineering skills to understand or make predictions about football? So if you are interested, so any kind of thing. Okay. So this is a very good place to find data, and you see there is İşbank challenge. So there is a, okay. Can we see its data? I don't use much Kaggle, so I am not that familiar, but I suggest you to be get familiar, because you can find data and find the codes. So it is a very good place to find a good project for you. So I really suggest you to investigate this Kaggle data. Okay, so this is, you see there, and you see this is a from İş Bankası, and it's a real challenge. It's a real life problem from a real company. So you see the data of this real life company, which is Türkiye İş Bankası, and to see how they do this kind of data engineering things. Okay, so I will not, because I don't know it. Okay, so really go to Kaggle to find your project. You can use Kaggle to find your project. Okay, so this is, we were actually looking for this tutorial. Okay, and it says that they will make a simple prediction So will it rain tomorrow? So what is this called? This is called, since will it rain tomorrow? It is a yes, no question. One or zero, yes or no, true or false. So this is called binary classification problem. At the end, what we do is, what we will do here for weather prediction is a simple binary classification problem. And we will use deep learning for that. And we will use PyTorch. Okay, so this is Australian weather prediction. So this is the data size. Let's go again to the Kaggle. So the context, it says that predict whether or not it will rain tomorrow. So it is a simple binary classification model. So this is the target feature, rain tomorrow is the target feature. So there are many features actually. So I will go here, just a minute. So you see there are 24 features. And one of them is the feature or we want to predict. I want to say again, so this is the number of columns, this is the number of rows. Each row is an observation, is a data. And each data or each observation has 24 features. Feature is the same thing as column, okay? And observation is the same thing as row from our point of view, okay? And there are 24 features and we are interested in the target feature rain tomorrow. Okay. So it is an Australian data. Weather data. It's a yes, no binary classification model. Okay. So there are some acknowledgements. Okay. So detail, the you see it is a 13 megabyte, the size of the data. It is not a gigabyte data, it is a 10 megabyte data. Okay, and it says that this data contains about 10 years of daily weather observation from numerous Australian weather stations. Okay, so what kind of columns we have? So this is the date, so this date. The day after that one, you see day by day, each row is an observation, each row is a day. Okay, so these are locations, good. So this is a temperature, mean and max values, rainfall, the amount of rainfall, evaporation. There is no data about evaporation for these observations, so NA not available. Sunshine, okay, so these are some other features. I cannot see more. Okay, so this is the data that we will be using here. Okay, do you have questions until now? Okay then, let's move to, so in every deep learning project, the most time consuming part is the data processing part. It is very time consuming and it is the most of your effort will go to this phase of data preprocessing. But this one is a very simple data. There is no noise in the data, I suppose. And you know what you want to do. So in real life, like this one, sorry. In real life problems, I cannot show it. I'll take this here. Okay, so in real life problems, such as this İş Bankası problem, you have many features, they will be outliers and the pre-processing step will take a lot of time. But these kinds of simple problems, and you have many notebooks here, I suppose. The pre-processing part is not that hard. Okay, so okay then. So You will not use all the 24 columns. You will use only 4 columns for predicting weather, whether it is going to rain or not tomorrow. So you have, these are the 4 features that are, that will be selected from the 24 features. And this is the target feature that you want to predict. Okay, these are the columns and you filter out these columns from the data frame. And the new data frame will no longer 24 columns, but it will have 4 plus 1, 5 columns. Okay. And if you look at the data, can we see the data? Maybe from here. Okay. You see some features are numeric. For example, minimum temperature and maximum temperature. And it's very good. Location is not numeric. Date is it's in its special format. So you see there are things that is not numeric. For example, rain tomorrow, the target value is yes or no. So it should be numeric because we will make subtraction, addition, matrix multiplication, these kinds of things. So we need numerical values here. Because of that, we will replace in the rain tomorrow and rain today features. We will replace no with zero, yes with one. And when you say in place true, you do not need to write df equals to, because it will do the this modification in place. So you do not write here df equals to df and replace things. Okay. And for the missing values, so you there are missing values. If you look at the original data here, what is a missing value? For example, here for that feature, you don't have a value. Here you have a value, but here you don't have a value. So for these kinds of things, you just get rid of it, because this tutorial is a simple tutorial. So it doesn't do the real data processing. It just does data pre-processing in a very simple way, because we are not, it is not a data engineering. Our purpose is not data engineering or data science. Our purpose is to build a neural network. So this tutorial is more oriented for deep learning, not for data engineering. But data engineering is another property that you must have if you really want to work on this kind of tasks. Okay, so you just drop values here, and at the end you have a data. So to understand data, your data, how is this data set is a balanced data set? What does balance means? So for example, for rain tomorrow, there's 2 values. If it was a balanced data set, the count of 0 and the count of 1 should be equal. So 50% of the data, it should be 0, and 50%, other 50% should be 1. But here we see that maybe 80%, I don't know for the moment, from this is just a count value, it is not a percentage of frequency, but I suppose 80% is 0 and 20% is 1. So it is not a balanced data set. So if in a data engineering project or a data engineering team, you must deal with these kinds of problems, because this is a problem. You have a null model. Will, if a model, if this is 80% and your model says that, if it says always 0, 80% of the time it will be correct and 20% of the time it will be wrong. So the accuracy will be 80%, even if it is a very dumb model. There is no intelligence in that model. The model just says always 0. There is no machine learning, there is no deep learning. It just says 0, always 0. A model that says always 0 will have 80% of accuracy. The performance will be 80%. So you see, if your day if your data set is not balanced, your model doesn't learn good things. It can just learn to say always zero. So it is a problem. Okay. Okay. Is this accuracy? I suppose it is, but it's not, for the moment, it's not that important. So it says, let me think about it for one moment.
Hocam çünkü şey, bu yukarıdaki soruda şey diyor hani, how many times did it train or not trained model diyor. Hani sadece yağıp yağmadığını vermiş gibi gösteriyor. Hani sıfır, yani %80 oranında yağmamış, %20 oranında yağmış gibi. Accuracy'den ziyade ben öyle anladım.
Evet. Evet. Şuraya bir bak, bir saniye. Let's go to the end. Okay. So in this case, so this is a there is a true label and there is a predicted label. Okay. So is it possible to draw here? Yes, maybe. Bakayım. Can I write spotlight for draw? So this is a draw. Okay. So so this is a true label. So if so it is, suppose I will really simplify things. So if I have 80 times no rain and 20 times, can you see my writing here? Hadi ya, göstermiyor mu? Ha, gösteriyor. İyi, güzel. Okay. So this is 80 times, this is true label by the way. So it says no rain and 20 times it's raining. Okay, my model, I have a very dumb model and it says 100 times no rain and 0 times raining. Okay, in this case, it is correct 80 times and it is wrong here this time. So accuracy is the diagonal. And by the way, these are, am I doing correctly? I'm not that sure. 80. Şu, ha, bu, bunu yanlış yere yazdım. Bir saniye, geri alayım. Ha. 80 is here, 20 is here. Okay. So this is zero. This is zero. Okay. Is it okay until now? So we have 100 numbers, 100 number, 100 observations, and true observation is 80 times it is no rain and 20 times it is raining. And I have a very dumb model and it always says 100 times no rain and 0 times rain. In this case, so this is the, and accuracy is this thing. So diagonal divided by all the values. So it is, böyle iyi oldu ya. Yani yazabiliyor mu ya? Okay, so this is the diagonal divided by all the values. So this is 80 plus, 20 plus, 0 plus, all of them. So it is, so the accuracy. So Burak, I think it is accuracy then.
Okay, okay.
Okay. Okay. 0.8. Okay. Peki burası nasıl siliniyor? Kalıyor mu? Bakalım. İlk defa yaptığım için bundan bir kurtulalım. Evet, kalıyor. Dur bakayım, nasıl sileceğim? Erase, kesin erase oldu diye bir şey vardır. Dur bakayım. Annotate. Clear. Clear oldu. Güzel. Peki. Bir de. Tamam. What, where we were. Okay, so this is an unbalanced data set. Okay now. And if you look at, it says 77% of the time no rain and 22% of the time it will rain. So so this is the data value counts divided by their size. Okay, these parts are data engineering parts, and from our point of view, for the moment, they are not very important, but I will give you the, how to say, the simple things about them. Okay, so you have, this is your X. From that X, you want to predict Y. So X is the features from the data set. So there are four features, and this is the thing that you want to predict. Now, you, with this train test split command, you divide your data in train and test. Okay, I will, since I learned how to draw, I will draw again. Okay. So this is your data set. Okay, so this is your data set, and it says that here 0.2, you will divide your data set into train and test. By the way, I want to say, so this is your data set, but there is last column, this one, is what you want to predict. So this is Y, okay, and this is X. So this is your original data set. Now, with this train test split, I will change the color, okay. So with this train test split, you say that, so this is 0.2 is here. Okay, so this is 0.2. So one fifth of the data set, so this will be test data set. So this will be X. Writing is not easy. X test. I cannot write. Okay, so this is X test. And here it will be X train. Okay, I cannot write. This is Y train. This is Y test. Okay, so these are the data set that you obtain here. So you have four components here: X test, Y test, X train, Y train. Okay, and these are in the format of the data frame, as you see. And now you need to turn into them to torch. Why you need this command torch? So these are X train. First of all, this is X train. You turn it, convert it to NumPy, and then you give it to the torch library here. So you just change the format of the data for library torch to understand. Now, if you, for example, if you use GPU, it will be better for it. So now this is your X train, Y train. You just give it them to the torch library. Okay. So if you look at the sizes, so these are the sizes. Okay. Clear all drawings. Okay. Now we will start the fundamental part for us. We will build our neural network with PyTorch. Until now, I showed you how to write PyTorch neural network, but I always take the simple way to build a neural network. Now we will use a more enhanced way. We will use CLAS, object-oriented programming. Okay, from now on, we will build our neural networks in PyTorch by using CLAS. Okay. So this at the end, I will talk about this code in a minute. I want to show you. So this will be our neural network. You see, it has one input layer, one hidden layer, another hidden layer, and the output layer. Why it has only one node at the end? Because this is a binary classification. It is a yes-no question. Will it rain tomorrow or not? Very simple. One question, one neuron is enough. But for example, if you try to understand handwritten characters such as, sorry, okay, so if you want to understand these handwritten characters, so 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you have 10 different digits here. So at the end, when if you will build a neural network to understand handwritten digit character, you at the end you need to have 10 neurons. Okay, but since this is a simple binary classification, one neuron at the output, one layer at the output layer is enough. Why we have 4 neurons here? Because this is our data set. This is about our data set. Our data set, as you see, it has 4 columns, 4 features. And this is the what we want to predict. Because of that, because X has 4 features, we have 4 neurons here. Because Y has one column, we have one neuron here. So these are definitive. You know, actually, you don't have a choice for input layer and output layer. It is given by your data set. But for hidden layers, you can write whatever you want. You can have this, the number of neurons in the hidden layer one, it could be 10, 100, 20, how much you want. Okay. We don't do that. I never seen that. It is not necessary. But for example, object detection problem. When you want, for example, let's go again here. So object detection. Okay, for example, this one. Okay, so you see, it says it understands it's a truck, it is a car. You see, the model, this is a convolutional neural network, by the way, and there is a special algorithm called YOLO. So it is an advanced neural network. Okay, it wants to predict the border of a car. Or here, the border, so this is a person. It is not a good image, sorry. But you have a person here, and it understands the person. And very interestingly, this is very interesting. So it can understand the person inside the car. You see, so there is a label person here. There is a label person, there is a label umbrella. I don't see the umbrella because the image is not good. But at the end, so this is a car. And there is a label of it. So what it understands here is the, I'm not sure, but I think it understands some reference point, for example, the middle of this box. So this is the middle of the point, and it understands the height and width of the box. So you cannot draw a whole a bigger box. You need to draw a box which is just fit to the object. So it only understands the center position, but it also understands the width and height. At the same time, it predicts three things, and they are using a combined thing. But if you want to predict for the previous case, if you want to just predict one of the digits, they are using a one-hot encoder. So again, so what is one-hot encoder? Let's see. Okay, can we see anything understandable? So this is something we can understand. Okay. So what is one-hot encoder? For example, you have red, yellow, green, three things, and they are not digitized. They are strings. We need to convert it to a digit. some numbers. So what we do, if we have three options, we build this tree size vector. So for red, we say that this is the column related to red. This is the column related to yellow. This is the column related to green. And we say that red is one, the others are zero. So because of that, we understand this is red. Okay, you just actually you have many possibilities, many categories, but all of them are zero except one, and that one category is the original category. Okay, so this is one hot angle, very simple thing. Okay, okay. So let's look at this one. Okay. For example, two options, apple, pear, two category, two options, then you can write 10101. So this is the thing related to apple. This is the thing related to pear, and you say, actually, in this case, and it says one hot encoding allows us to turn nominal categorical data into features with numerical values. Okay, so there is no order relationships. For example, okay, these are all important data engineering problems. I want to say just one thing. So for example, actually you turn it to two columns, but actually one column is enough. So, okay. So forget about this part. You understand if this is one, you understand it is apple. If zero, you understand it is pear. So the next column is not enough. Okay, these are some details. Let's go back to our tutorial. Okay. Sorry. Okay, then. So this will be the neural network that we will build by with PyTorch, and we will use object-oriented programming. Okay. So first of all, from the model, NNN model. So this is the class. This is our neural network. And the name of our class neural network is NET, and it is inherited from existing PyTorch library for neural networks, which is NNN module. So it has a constructor, and it has a forward method. So this is the constructor of this class. And so this is in Java, you know, there is a special keyword this, which indicates the class itself. Here, this self indicates this class itself, okay? And you give number of features. Number of features is the initial number of features, actually. How you start your neural network. How many features you have in the input layer. Okay. So you say you initialize your parent class here with a special keyword super, okay. Then you start to build your neural network. So these are, I always told you that a matrix multiplication is a linear transformation. So this is a linear transformation from number of features to five features. This is the first fully connected layer. So this is the fully connected. So this is the transformation here from 4 to 5. Okay. So number of features is 4 to 5 linear transformation. This is the first one, FC1. Okay. And you need another one here, FC2, which is this one. Now you have 5. You transform it to 3 features. And this again, this is a linear transformation, just a matrix multiplication. This is 5 to 3. So this is FC2. And here you have FC3 from 3 to 1, last one. So So these are your linear transformations. But linear transformations is not enough to understand complex data. Let me show you again. Linearly separable data. Okay, very nice. You see, what does it mean? Linearly separable data. So you see, so you have here a different category of data. For example, these are men, these are women. Okay, you can discriminate these two categories. It could be apple and pear. I don't know, cats and dogs. Not important to me. You have two category here. If you can use a linear line here to separate in the two dimension, it is just a line. In three dimension, it is a plane like here, you see? So this is in three dimensional data, you need a separating plane. It is called hyperplane. If you have many dimension, you will have a hyperplane. Okay. It is not easy to visualize after three dimension, but this is if you can separate your data with a line or plane or hyperplane, it is called linearly separable data. And if you have linearly separable data, it is very easy. And with just linear transformation, without using any nonlinear activation function, you can discriminate your data. Okay, where is it? It is here. But for example, this data is not linearly separable. Here, I want to annotate now. Okay. So for example, this data here, you can separate with a line. But here, you cannot separate with a line. You need a more complex boundary. So this is a very simple boundary. It is just a line, but this boundary is not simple. It's because of that you need nonlinear activation functions. For example, this one, you cannot discriminate this data with a line. Why? For example, if I draw a line like this one, I mix everything. So here, all of them is one category according to my model. All of them is another category, but actually I made a big mistake. Okay. So what can I do? For example, I can do this one. Maybe this is a better line because all of them, at least I do all of them correct, and all of these are correct. But this part is I make mistake. According to me, these are all red, these are all green, but actually this is also red. So you see, if your data is not linearly separable, it is a little bit complex, and because of that, you need nonlinear activation functions. Okay. Again, you see. Okay. Okay, then let's continue. Okay, so here, these are our linear transformations, but these linear transformations from here to here, it should be followed by a nonlinear activation function. This is the forward function here, it takes input X, it transforms it here to here. Then it applies a nonlinear function ReLU, and this is the X outputted from here. Now we are here. I will again annotate. Okay. So this X now it is here. you apply linear transformation. Linear transformation is a matrix multiplication. So now X is the input of this layer. So this is the half of, I couldn't draw. So you are inside it. You are the input of, so this self FC1X is the input of this layer. And then you apply this FC ReLU. Then this, now you are at here. This is the output of this layer. Okay, so now you are here, X. Okay, after that, here, this part is you apply FC2 to X. So it is a linear transformation. What is FC2? This is it. From 5 to 3, 5 to 3, there is a transformation, matrix multiplication. So this is the input of this layer. Okay, this is the half of this layer. Okay, then after that, here, you apply again a ReLU. So after this ReLU, this is the output of this layer. Now it is X. This is this X. Okay. And what you do later? Okay. So later you have this thing. This is it. So FC3X. What is FC3X? This is it. 3 to 1. So this is, this was 3. Now you make a transformation 3 to 1. So X is here. Now, and after that, you follow it by sigmoid. This, make attention, give attention here. So this is sigmoid. So it is not ReLU. All the activation functions here was ReLU, but now you apply sigmoid. Why we apply sigmoid? So this is the question. So after this applying sigmoid, you return it. So this is the sigmoid of X. Why we are using here sigmoid? Do you remember? Can somebody write from the chat? Why we apply sigmoid here? Yes, it is in between 0 and 1. So it will be, the output will be in 0 and 1. So it can be interpreted as a probability. Let's see also here, sigmoid function again. So you see sigmoid function, whatever the input is, the output will always be 0 and 1. So it can be interpreted as probability. So what is that probability? What is the meaning of this? It is a probability of rain. I will try to write here. Pro, çok zor. Ah, text var. Probability of rain. So this is it. So this is at the end, after, so you give at X, you give the X input, your value observation, then you apply linear transformations, nonlinear transformations by ReLU here, ReLU here, again, linear transformations, but after that you apply sigmoid because this is the end, this is will be the output, and you need probability of frame at the end. Because of that, you don't use ReLU, you use sigmoid. Okay. When you have only one neuron at the end, you need to apply sigmoid. But if you have more than one neuron at the end, okay, like this one, MNIST data. You have, in the MNIST data, you have 10 classes. Okay, in this case, when you have these 10 classes, you cannot apply sigmoid function. Instead of it, you need to apply softmax. Let's look at what this looks like. Okay. So I will erase all the things here. Okay. So when you have you have more than one neuron at the output layer and you have these values here, as you see, you apply softmax function. So what is softmax? It is for every values here, you take the exponent, a to the value. For example, first one is 1.3, a to the power 1.3, a to the power 5.1. And you, for every one of them, you divide them by the sum and you obtain these values. So what, again, since you divide by the sum of all the exponents, again, the here, all of them, when you add them up, they are one. So again, you can interpret this as a probability. So at the end, of the neural network, we want to get probability. So probability of rain, in this our case, probability of rain. In the handwritten digit case, it is probability of being two, or probability of being three, or probability of being zero, like that. Okay, we want to get these probabilities. And as you see, so this is the greatest value here. It is still greatest after this operation, but the difference, for example, from with five and two, the difference is not that much. So if this is 90, it should be 45, but it is five. So what is softmax? Okay, for you to better understand, softmax versus hardmax. Is there some called hardmax? Okay. So, okay, if it was a hardmax, it will just say that probability of this will be one, all the others will be zero. But instead of that, we say that we increase the probability of the bigger value. So already bigger gets bigger, smaller gets smaller, bigger, yes, bigger gets bigger. Here, big value gets much bigger and smaller values get much smaller, as you see. And we turn these to probabilities. Okay, so this softmax is for multi-category classification. In our case, we need only binary classification. So because of that, we can only use sigmoids. Okay, do you have questions until now? It's clear. Okay, so this is our neural network, and this is how we build our neural network with PyTorch in object-oriented way. Okay then. So now it talks about here activation functions. It talks about ReLU. It is just a max zero or x. So you see, it is the function, nonlinear function. This is sigmoid. It is interpreted as a probability. Okay. Now, since it is a binary classification, we need to use binary cross entropy laws. Okay. You can, if you want, you can look for this also. Let's look at it together. You don't see it. Okay. For the optimizer, we are using a gradient descent based optimizer, which is called Adam optimizer. Okay, so you give it your data to GPU if it is available. Okay, you give your neural network to the device, device is GPU or CPU. If it is available, you give it to the device, your criterion also. Now, weather forecasting, by the way, to calculate the accuracy, this is what he used. This is not important. Let's go to the training phase. Okay, so for a given number of epochs, it takes the train data, it makes prediction on that train data with the neural network it built. Let's look at the neural network again. So this is the neural network, and it has a forward function. When you say here net x train, actually it's implicitly runs the forward function with the given x value here, okay? And it makes a prediction, okay? So this is your prediction. Torch squeeze, it just get rid of the some dimensions. It is the same data with low dimension, okay? Here, now with the criterion, what was criterion? It is a bind, let's look at it, criterion. So our optimizer, Adam optimizer with the given learning rate, you give the parameters of your neural network, and criterion is your binary cross entropy loss. Okay. With that binary cross entropy loss, you calculate your loss, your error value. And based on that error value, you will backpropagate your error to the parameters, and you will make update on the parameters with the gradient descent based algorithm, which is called Adam algorithm, okay? By the way, each 100 times you calculate accuracy. Okay, you make predictions, calculate accuracy. Okay, not important. You make the accumulated gradients will be zero out here. And with this backward function, the error will be backpropagated. You know, we made a lot of course on the mathematical details of the backpropagation. But when you use PyTorch, you don't need to calculate the derivatives. You don't need to calculate the chain rule. It is all done automatically with this backward function. All the derivatives are calculated for you. Here, when you say optimizer step, in that case, all the parameter updates are done for you with the given optimizer, which is Adam optimizer. So using PyTorch makes it easy for you. So here, again, I repeat, here you calculate the derivatives and you update the parameters with the derivative. So what was gradient descent algorithm? Remember it, you just update your parameter in the opposite direction of the loss function derivative, and you are using a learning rate. So again, gradient descent. Okay, so you see, you have a loss function like this, and each time you run, you initialize your weight randomly, and each time you approach to the best weight that minimizes this loss function, and your step size here determined by the learning rate. By the way, this is the gradient descent algorithm. So you have a parameter W, and each time W, so this is the algorithm, W equals W minus alpha times the derivative. Okay, so with this basic gradient descent algorithm, you reach to the minimum. This is the simple optimizer. Adam optimizer is a little bit a more advanced version of this one, but for the moment it is enough for us. You just know that Adam optimizer is a better way of gradient descent. So this, in this step function, your parameters are updated. Okay, and you have the outputs here. Okay. After the training is done, you see, so this is epoch 0, epoch 100. It will go until epoch 1000. After 1000 iteration, each time your accuracy changes. So it starts with 77. You see, why it is 77? You remember, our data set is unbalanced, and a dumb model can do this 77. It's the, because of this, let's go to our data set. You see, this is the this must be the starting point, because any dumb model can produce this result. If you say always zero, this will be your accuracy. So because of that, it starts with that kind of accuracy, but after each training with the data and all these parameter updates, it can reach to this point in the accuracy. And it is not much, actually, it should be greater, I suppose. Okay, if you are happy with your model, you can save the model and to some place. And after that, you can send that model to your colleague, or if you're a consultant, you can send that model to the company that you are working for. And that company can load the model that you send them, and without any training, they can run it. And with an API, in a web service API, maybe they can, in a framework, in a website, they can run this code. So for your projects, so it is not just enough to run these neural networks. It should be also alive. It should be, you should also put your models into a website. For example, you can use Flask, Django, or Fast API, and you can make it alive. And then you can put it, you can put or deploy your model to the Amazon or maybe Heroku, and you can make it alive. And you can show your model to somebody, and maybe they can hire you. Maybe even our company can hire you. Okay, so you can use again classification report. It gives you the precision values, recall values, F1 scores. Precision and recall is very important. Okay, so. And you can, in a confusion matrix, you can show your accuracy here. So, and you are ready to make further predictions. Okay. So today, what the important part for today is this part. This neural network, how you build neural network. For example, this is the neural network that you built. By the way, I think I sent you the link, but okay. So this is the original source. I will send it to you. I really like this thing. Okay. So this is the original source for, actually this is a book, and this is the fourth chapter of the book. And you can access it freely. So this is what we have done is, so this is build your first neural network. So we built this one, and you can also, you have the neural notebooks here. And for example, I can show you the, so this is the code. And this is, there is a code here to visualize a neural network. So let me run this. Quickly, may I run it? Run anyway, okay. So this is a code. You don't need to understand the inside of the code, but what this code does is a very, very good thing. It can visualize a sequential model. So what is the problem? Okay, so for any given neural network, you can visualize your neural network. So this code is very important code, I suppose, to understand or give a picture of your neural network. So you don't understand the inside of the code, but it is very good to use it. I will try to use it. So these are the code that we talk about. I will not talk about them again. I will just run the code. You can also run on your own. I think it will be very educational. You will learn a lot. Okay. So this is the part for neural network building. And after that, here, you run it. So this is it. So n vis is visualize this neural network. Now I will change my neural network, this neural network, to something else, and I will show it to you. So let's do neural network, not 5, 2, 2, 1. Okay, so I just change them and I want to see the new. Okay, so this is the new neural network. So you see, then you build a neural network. With this NVIS, you can visualize your neural network. So it is very good for you to understand what you have done. Okay. Okay then. And after that, you can run your codes and you can run it. And I want to continue with one more thing, actually, since I am curious. So I want to open CodeApp. I want to open our last autoencoder Python notebook. Okay. The autoencoder. Actually, I didn't want to train it, but not important. There are a lot of things. What I want to do is, I just want to steal this code, this visualizer code here. And if it is possible, I want to use it here. Let's visual code. Okay. So. Now I want to build do we have a neural network here? I want to change one of our neural networks, for example, this one. Okay. I want to change this neural network and I want to write it in the new way, the object-oriented way, if it is possible. Let's try it. So where is the code? So this is the code. Now I will, instead of this this way of writing, I want to write in this way. So it takes, so it starts with 25, as you see. So and after that it continues with 10. And after that I have 10 to 3. Okay, so this is actually, this is encoder part, and after that I will have a decoder part. This time this 3 to 10, this one, and now I need to have a fourth one, 10 to number of features again, which is 25. I have this one. Okay, so what I do is I take in the forward function, I take the X, I apply FC1, okay, and I apply FC2. Okay, so I come to this part. So again, this is the encoder part. Now I need to do decoder part. Okay. So this is FC3, this part, with this ReLU. ReLU is actually, they are separated lines here, but in one line, ReLU and FC3 is done. And lastly, I will do this one, which is, by the way, it should be FC4. Okay. So last one is, it is just FC4. Okay. And I will just return X. So this is the neural network. Instead of this, I write this one. And I want to see it. I want to see by this function. How do we call that function? We are calling with this one. Okay. Yes, but I didn't. So, okay. Okay. So here I will not write anything because if I don't write anything, n features will be 25. Okay, let's see it if it's possible. It's not possible. Happy colors. Okay, I need some more things to steal from here. So what are they? What are they? Did you import unlist? No, I didn't import unlist. I just copy this function, view through, there is a file name, network.gv. What is this network.gv? I don't have it. Network.gv. File name. From graph is the graph. I need. So what is this network.gv? Where is it? The colors. Okay, let's take this one also, just to try. Güzel. Çok çirkin. Aldığını göremiyoruz. 25 biraz fazla geldi. Şöyle yapalım. Ne yapalım? Bari 5 yapalım. Evet. Wow. So this is, and 10 is a little bit much. Make it 4. Bunu da 3 yapalım. Evet. Okay. So maybe let's do this also. Okay. So this is the neural network. As you see, it is start with 3, then it goes to 4, 3, 4, then it goes to 1, and after that in the decoder part 1 to 4, and 4 to 3, which is n features here. Okay, so this is for seeing, but I think it is not good for seeing big neural networks. Unfortunately, I would be very happy if it is if we could visualize big neural networks. Okay, then. So with this, from now on, we will not use this sequential and easy parts. We will use this. This is a more professional way of building neural networks. So we should use this object-oriented version. Okay. Okay then. So it is all for today. If you have questions, I can listen. Otherwise, we can finish our course. Thank you. Thank you all. I am finishing the course.